My name is Chris Martin. I'm on the faculty at Georgia Tech, and I'm going to talk about interpersonal theory and help you learn some vocabulary you can use during teamwork. Before we jump to teams, let's start by talking about people. If you're asked to describe a person, you'll probably start by describing their personality. You'll list stable traits they have. You might describe one person as introverted and intellectual, another person as outgoing and athletic, and another person as quarrelsome and high-strung. These sorts of explanations focus on one person at a time. There is another way to describe personality, however, and that's to describe people in relation to other people. This is where interpersonal theory comes in. Interpersonal theory is rooted in the work of a psychologist named Harry Stack Sullivan, who lived from 1892 to 1942. Even though Sullivan was a psychologist, he was inspired by the physicist James Maxwell, known for the dynamical theory of the electromagnetic field, in which Maxwell described the force field created by charged particles rather than just the particles themselves. Inspired by Maxwell's theory, Sullivan decided to focus on how behavior is a function of the interpersonal field that's created by the combination of personalities in a group. Sullivan's work influenced Timothy Leary, who was a graduate student in psychology in the 1940s. Leary was to later become famous for his psychedelic experiments, and he eventually inspired the Beatles song Come Together. However, in the 1940s, when he was just a graduate student at UC Berkeley, Leary spent his time observing people who were receiving group therapy at a Unitarian church in Berkeley for his dissertation work. Like Sullivan, Leary illustrated interpersonal dynamics with diagrams that look like field diagrams from physics. Here's one of the diagrams in his dissertation. Incidentally, you can find his full dissertation on archive.org. Leary also introduced a new idea, a circular classification system, or circumplex. Rather than using a scale with two opposing poles, as psychologists often do, Leary plotted the mechanisms of group behavior using a scale where every item resembles the items adjacent to it, and is opposed to the item across from it. Here's another diagram from Leary's dissertation with a circumplex. You can see the mechanisms at the top and bottom are directs and submits, which are mutual opposites. So there's a vertical axis corresponding to assertiveness or control. The mechanisms at the left and right are condemns and approves, so there's a horizontal axis corresponding to affection or disaffection. If we go back to directs at the top, you can see the adjacent items are resists and teaches. These are both types of assertive behavior, but teaches is on the affection side and resists on the disaffection side. This early version of the circumplex was later refined by Leary and other psychologists. The latest version looks something like this. The vertical axis is assertiveness. At a high level of assertiveness, you're exerting control over others, whereas at low levels, you're going along or submitting to what other people want. Some people call this axis agency, because to be agentic means to intentionally have an impact on objects and people. The horizontal axis is compassion. At a high level of compassion, you're very caring toward other people, and at a low level of compassion, you're not paying attention to other people. To simplify this diagram, let's use a single word for these four points: warm, cold, assured, and submissive. We can now fill out other parts of the circle. If you have a combination of warmth and assuredness, you are enthusiastic, whereas if you have a combination of coldness and submissiveness, you are shy. If you're cold and assured, you're bossy or strict. If you're warm but unassured, you're forgiving. You can see how each item in these corners resembles the items adjacent to it. You can even insert words between these pairs of words, but we won't go to that level of detail today. This form of diagramming interpersonal behavior is connected to field theory because each of these attributes invites a response from other people and thus creates a force field. Leading or being assured invites following or being submissive. Conversely, following invites leading. Warmth invites warmth and coldness invites coldness. In other words, at the top and bottom, you're inviting the opposite behavior in others. At the left and right, you're inviting the same behavior in others. Some of these adjectives are more socially desirable than others, but it's important to note that all of them are functional and we all have the capacity to engage in behavior that matches every point here. There are times when you want to focus on work and not get involved in a social conversation, for example, when you're studying at a library. In this situation, you're cold to the people around you and they're cold to you. You may have a similar situation when you're traveling and you don't want to start a conversation with your seatmate. You signal indifference to them in order to communicate that you'd like them to be indifferent to you. There are also times when you have to be strict, such as when someone behaves badly. There are times when it makes sense to be introverted, such as when you're tired. And there are times when it makes sense to be submissive, such as when someone has more expertise than you. If you take a quiz on your interpersonal styles, and you may be assigned one by your professor, you'll probably find that you have a moderate score on many of these axes. If you think of the center as 0 and the outer circle as 20, and you plot your scores, you'll probably get a score of around 10 on most axes, and a slightly higher score on one or two axes. You may want that higher score to indicate that you're enthusiastic or warm, but the world contains a diverse range of personalities, and it's normal to find that you have some other profile. The fact that behavior can be classified this way, in terms of what it invites or evokes, has implications for group work. First, people are frustrated when their behavior doesn't get a complimentary response, which is the response that is invited. As I talked about earlier, the complement of dominance is submission, and the complement of submission is dominance. So if you're trying to lead the group, you're hoping that other people go along, and if you want someone to take charge, you're hoping that someone steps up. These are complementary behaviors. People get a bit frustrated when they receive behavior that's not complimentary, especially when it's exactly the opposite of what you're inviting. If you're trying to take the lead, you don't like it when someone else responds by trying to be the leader. And if you're trying to be passive and hoping someone else will lead, you're frustrated when everyone else is passive too, and there's no leader. Also, warmth invites warmth and coldness invites coldness, so in these cases too, someone can respond in a complimentary or anti-complimentary manner. If you're trying to discern why your team has problems, try to plot the behavior of various people on the circumplex and see if there's a persistent pattern of anti-complimentary behavior. If you're trying to explain to someone that you're frustrated with their behavior, you may also explain the problem by talking about anti-complimentary patterns. Second, people are frustrated when others use the wrong tactic to evoke a certain kind of behavior. If you want people to be compassionate and warm toward you, you're likely to evoke that behavior by being compassionate and warm toward them. If, on the other hand, you scold people for being unfriendly or uncompassionate, there's only a small chance you will succeed because scolding tends to evoke coldness, not warmth. The circumplex is useful because you can treat it like a compass and figure out what direction to move in to reach a destination. If you're condescending, in the region of excessive strictness and coldness, for example, and you want to be moderately assertive, you mainly need to move in the direction of greater warmth, and then only slightly in the direction of less agency. A useful exercise is to take a circumplex and plot where you are and where you intend to be with any group of people. Then separate the degree to which you need to change your level of agency from the degree to which you need to change your level of warmth. Third, people are frustrated when you take something too far. Any point on this circumplex can be taken to excess. Coldness can turn into cold-heartedness, and warmth can turn into overly self-sacrificing behavior. Along the upper half of the circle, strictness can turn into arrogance, agentic behavior can become dictatorial, enthusiasm can turn into intrusiveness. On the lower side, shyness can turn into avoidance, submissiveness can turn into a lack of assertiveness, and being too forgiving can make you gullible and exploitable. So if there are team problems that prompt you to reflect on your behavior, or you need to ask someone else to reflect on their behavior, you might start with the circumplex and look at how a tendency has gone from a normal level to a dysfunctional level. Fourth, it's frustrating when someone spins around the circle too much and becomes unpredictable. Both the problem of degree and spin involve a deviation from what's considered normal. When you have a high level of spin, it's hard for people to know what type of response you want. You're not clear because you're not in one place for very long. Fifth, the whole team drifts toward the lower left corner. Up to now, I've talked about individual behavior, but the circumplex can also be used to describe an entire team. A team where people are enthusiastic about working together, open with each other, and assertive toward each other is in the top right corner. A team where people try to be very agreeable and not irritate each other is a little south of that point. Filling out the opposite end, you can find teams where everyone ridicules everyone else, or people avoid interacting with each other. You can find teams where people are generally assertive or unassertive about their opinions, and teams where people try to outperform each other or avoid competing with each other. Teams that spend most of their time in the green area of the circle tend to fare well. Teams that spend most of their time in the red area of the circle tend to fare badly. So if your entire team is in the red area, you may need to ask for an external intervention. When you're part of a student team, your professors want you to work together to find creative solutions to problems. This means they want a team where people are open and considerate toward one another, and where some members aren't confused or frustrated by the behavior of other members. We hope that you'll use the vocabulary you learn in this video to communicate about what's going well and what's going poorly in your teams. Remember that it's normal for personalities to vary, and all teams have some tension. However, when you have persistent problems, you need a common language to resolve those problems and function well.